Did you want to test the witness table too, or? You won't be able to read, so here, give me your thing. Yeah. You don't have to do each one unless you want to. Do you always do each one?
No.
Oh.
I usually don't do any of it. I mean, I grab one, but.
You know, one time I had one that was out in here, so.
Yeah.
It was like the middle one or something, you know, working. The one time I was in here.
I thought I just had a pen. I guess not. Oh, we need our papers.
Yeah, we don't have anything.
I
In order, I do apologize for being 10 minutes late. I note a presence of a quorum. Subcommittee on Indian and Alaska Native Affairs is meeting today to hear testimony on two Indian land acquisition and land use issues. Under Committee Rule 4, the opening statements of myself and the ranking member will be heard and will receive any other member's testimony or opening statements for the record. I ask unanimous consent that the gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Pierce, and gentleman from Mr. California, Mr. Jaramandi, be allowed to join us on the dais and participate in the hearings without any objections so ordered. Today, placing land in trust for tribes is one of the most solemn actions the federal government taking regarding American Indians. For this reason, it's imperative for the subcommittee to attain a clear and understanding of the laws and policies concerning when, where, under what process fee land should be acquired in trust. Today, the committee is going to hear from tribal leaders and a private landowner concerning two separate disputes. These cases highlight challenges facing tribes and non-tribal interests trying to resolve disagreements over creating new trust lands outside existing Indian reservation. As the subcommittee examines these cases, a question we may wish to consider is whether current law is adequate for these controversies to be settled without intervention of the Congress or the Department of Interior. Two cases before us today involve the Navajo and Sunni tribes negotiating over a division of the Fort Wingate Army Depot, which was closed under the base or the bracking of the fields, and the Chumash Indians and non-tribal landowners of the San Andres Valley, where Chumash tribal government wishes to increase its trust land base over what is exercised sovereignty. Leading off the hearings will be Director of the Bureau of Indian Affairs, who will give us an overview of the agency fee for trust process and status update on Fort Wingate lands. I look forward to hearing the witnesses of the day, and now I recognize Mr. Luan for an opening statement.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. And today we're going to hear from three tribes on important issues relating to disputes between tribes, state, and local governments over use and development of tribal lands. One of the main responsibilities we have here in Congress is to help tribes address disputes, settlements, and land into trust issues, especially when mutual agreements are hard to reach. We're going to hear from several witnesses, including the Santa Ynez Band of Chumash Indians located in Southern California, regarding a land use dispute between the tribe, local governments, and community groups. And we're also going to hear from a member from the community. There are concerns relating to the tribe's land into trust application to the Department of Interior, which has been appealed, and I hope we can shed some light on the issues surrounding this dispute. We are also going to hear from tribal leaders who reside in my congressional district regarding a land dispute between their two tribes, which I hope we can move forward in resolving today. More specifically, Zuni Pueblo and the Navajo Nation have come to an impasse in negotiations over the Fort Wingate Army Depot lands, which are slated to be returned to the two tribes under a negotiated agreement. I believe when tackling these very difficult land issues, the only way to move forward is to have meaningful consultations and good faith between the tribes, local governments, and at the federal level. We must work on a government-to-government level to resolve complex and many historical issues. Meaningful consultation, good faith, government-to-government. These are a few phrases I would like to highlight as we move forward with the discussion today, especially as we continue to emphasize the importance and respect for tribal sovereignty. The very need for resolving land disputes issues as a legislative body is due to injustices that took place throughout our collective history. These injustices have impacted our tribal communities forever. As I travel around my state and talk to many of the tribal leaders I represent back home, one resounding theme I always hear is getting the federal government out of internal dealings between the tribes. But what do we do when two tribes are not able to sit down in good faith with one another? What do we do when there's an impasse that cannot be overcome? Do we get involved as a legislative body to force the tribes to do something they may not agree with? Do we pick winners and losers? I do not agree with that approach, and I know that the tribal leaders in the room don't agree with that approach either. I'm hoping that we can sit down and solve this issue. When an impasse occurs, I believe there is always a greater understanding that we will all have about the history of our land loss that tribes have suffered throughout the history of this country. Land is tied to the identity and longevity of our cultures and language, and where we all once existed together on ancestral homelands. Before, there is room for us to exit together once again. That is the principle we have to remember when working together, even if there are areas where there is disagreement. I hope, Mr. Chairman, that we can come together as brothers and sisters in our respective responsibilities as leaders to help resolve these issues. And I look forward to talking about some of the complex issues here today and hearing the testimony of our witnesses. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
I thank the gentleman. We'll hear from our witnesses. We have one panel today. And will you please take your seats? Michael Black, Director of Bureau of Indian Affairs. Gerald Huey, Tribal Council of the Suni Pueblo. Speaker Johnny Nays, Navajo Nation. Chairman Vincent Armanta, Santa Ynez Band of Chumash Indians, and Marshall Grossman, a private landholder in Santa Barbara. At this time, I'll recognize Mr. Pierce to introduce his constituent.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I had hoped to introduce Governor Kataki from Zuni Pueblo. He had to go home suddenly on family emergency, but I'm honored to recognize the Honorable Gerald Huey, Sr. He's a tribal council member of the Zuni tribe and just does a fantastic job, and we welcome you here today from New Mexico. Thank you very much, and would yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, General. Mr. Armandi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to introduce to the committee Marshall Grossman, a long-time friend of mine from the area in question, the Santa Ynez Valley, where he owns property, also a very prominent lawyer in Los Angeles, and I'm sure you'll find his testimony of interest.
Thank you. Mr. Black.
Good afternoon. Chairman Young, Ranking Member Lujan, and members of the subcommittee. My name is Michael Black, and I'm the Director of the Bureau of Indian Affairs. Thank you for the opportunity to present the Department of Interior's views on this oversight hearing. In the subcommittee's invitation to the department, the subcommittee posed several questions to the department. First, to address the issue of the department's rules and procedures for taking land into trust when local governments or private landowners oppose the jurisdictional changes that occur when the federal government acquires land. Second, the subcommittee asked the department to address the issue of land status at the former military base at Fort Wingate in New Mexico. In 1887, Congress passed the General Allotment Act, which divided tribal land into 80 and 160-acre parcels for individual tribal members. The allotments to individuals were to be held in trust for the Indians for no longer than 25 years, after which the owner would hold fee title to the land. So-called surplus lands, that is, those lands that were not allotted to individual members, were taken out of tribal ownership and conveyed to non-Indians. The General Allotment Act resulted in an enormous loss of tribally owned lands. Approximately two-thirds of tribal lands were lost as a result of the land divestment policies established by the General Allotment Act and diverse homestead acts. The Secretary of Interior's annual report for fiscal year ending June 30, 1998, reported that Indian-owned lands have been diminished from 130 million acres in 1887 to only 49 million acres by 1933. In 1934, Congress enacted the Indian Reorganization Act, or the IRA, with the intent to halt the federal policy of allotment and assimilation, to reverse the negative impact of allotment policies, and to secure for all Indian tribes a land base on which to engage in economic development and self-determination. With the IRA, Congress authorized the Secretary to restore tribal ownership of the remaining surplus lands and to secure homelands for Indian tribes by acquiring land to be held in trust for Indian tribes. Trust acquisition is essential to tribal self-determination and provides a number of economic development opportunities for tribes. Trust acquisitions also provide the tribes the opportunity and ability to enhance housing opportunities for their citizens, as well as opportunities for energy development and protection of natural resources. Taking land into trust is an important decision, not only for the Indian tribe seeking the determination, but for the local community where the land is located. The transfer of land from fee title to trust status may have tax and jurisdictional consequences that must be considered before a discretionary trust acquisition is completed. The department believes its regulations at 25 CFR Part 151 provide sufficient opportunities for state and local units of government to provide views on applications of land to be acquired in trust. Under those regulations, state and local governments are given a 30-day period to submit written comments concerning jurisdictional problems and potential regulatory conflicts, as well as tax impacts that may result from the land acquisition. The wealth of a tribe or an individual is not a consideration when evaluating the need for additional land. One of the factors considered is the need of the applicant tribe for additional land, but wealth or lack thereof is not one of the factors for consideration. In addition, state and local governments, as well as the general public, may submit comments related to environmental impacts in the review process under the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA, requirements. Under NEPA, many local governments serve as cooperating agencies and thus participate very closely in the department's NEPA review process. Finally, if the department decides to acquire land in trust, it must publish at least 30 days' notice of this decision pursuant to 25 CFR Part 151 prior to acquiring trust title to the land. The 30-day notice period provides an opportunity for interested parties, including state and local units of government, to appeal the proposed acquisition. The department takes seriously its authority and responsibility to consider applications to acquire land in trust on behalf of tribes and individual Indians. And we also take seriously our responsibility to afford an opportunity to interested parties to comment on fee-to-trust applications pursuant to regulations. Regarding Fort Wingate, the Fort Wingate property is an inactive U.S. Army installation located in New Mexico on lands withdrawn from the public domain and reserved for military use when the fort was established in 1870. The property is located east of Gallup, New Mexico, and near both Pueblo of Zuni and Navajo Nation lands in New Mexico. Fort Wingate closed in 1993 as a result of the Base Realignment and Closure Act. Following the closure, a survey determined that the installation contained approximately 20,700 acres of public domain lands, which were divided into 22 parcels. These lands have cultural and historical significance to both the Navajo Nation and the Pueblo of Zuni. The Department of Interior indicated that, upon satisfactory completion of environmental restoration, many of the parcels could be returned to its jurisdiction with the intent of eventually transferring the lands into trust for the Navajo Nation and the Pueblo of Zuni. Since 1990, the Army has been working with the Department, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, the New Mexico Environmental Department, the Navajo Nation, and the Pueblo of Zuni on the cleanup and return of withdrawn public domain lands at Fort Wingate. Once the Army satisfactorily finishes environmental restoration activities and the Department determines the lands are suitable for return to the public domain, the Department will revoke the military reservation status and may transfer jurisdiction and management of the parcels to the BIA. The next intended step, placing lands into trust status for the benefit of specific tribes, requires congressional action. To date, the BLM has prepared public landowners officially transferring 5,429 acres, or three parcels of Fort Wingate lands, to BIA jurisdiction and management. Currently, the BIA is overseeing preparation of an environmental site assessment on four additional parcels, comprising 1,103 acres. When the assessment is completed, the BIA will notify BLM of the suitability of lands for transfer into BIA management. This concludes my prepared statement, and I'll be happy to answer any questions the subcommittee may have. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Michael Black, Gerald Uzi, Tribal Council of the SUNY Pueblo.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, Congressman Lujan, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for this opportunity to testify before you today about the steps needed to return the lands at former Fort Wingate to the Zuni Tribe and Navajo Nation, a matter that is one of the highest priorities for the Zuni Tribe. My name, as stated earlier, is Gerald Huey Sr. I am an elected tribal councilman for the Pueblo of Zuni. With me today is another tribal councilman, Lauren Likula Sr., and our Fort Wingate coordinator, Daryl Sabatse, and our legal counsel, Daniel Press. I would like to begin by thanking Congressman Pierce for introducing H.R. 4187. That bill would transfer three of the 25 reuse parcels of the land at the former Fort Wingate in New Mexico to the Zuni and Navajo tribes, with Parcel 1 going to Zuni and Parcel 15 and 17 going to the Navajo Nation. The Navajo Nation has attacked Congressman Pierce for introducing this legislation, claiming that it meddles in intertribal affairs. I am mystified why Navajo is saying this, since as a document attached to my written testimony shows, both tribes agreed to this division of these three parcels back in 1997. As a result, H.R. 4187 simply carries out what the two tribes agreed to 15 years ago. Navajo has also complained that the bill does not provide for a 50-50 division. This is also a diversion, since they know the bill is just the first step. However, the main purpose of my testimony today is to ask Congress to expand H.R. 4187 so that it transfers all 25 of the reused parcels at Fort Wingate to the two tribes. This legislation is needed for two reasons. First, Congress must authorize the transfer of all these parcels to the tribes before the Interior Department can put them in trust for us. It therefore makes sense to do it in a single piece of legislation rather than addressing three parcels in 4187 and have to legislate on the other 22 at some future time. But secondly, the legislation transferring all 25 parcels to the two tribes is needed to break 15 years of futile negotiations between the Zuni tribe and the Navajo Nation regarding the division of the land at Fort Wingate. Congress must break the deadlock so that the Zuni tribe can finally get its share of the parcels that have commercial value so it can engage in economic development activities that can reduce our 65% unemployment rate and that can help to stop our young educated Zunis from leaving the reservation because they cannot find decent jobs there. The Zuni tribe, with 11,300 members, is culturally rich but economically poor. While we have been successful in preserving our culture and language, we suffer from extreme poverty and a 65% unemployment rate. A main reason for this is that our reservation is located in a remote corner of New Mexico, away from the interstate highways, rail lines, natural gas pipelines, and the kind of electric transmission needed for commercial development. In contrast, the 17,000 plus acres at Fort Wingate that the Army no longer can provide the Zuni tribe and the Navajo Nation with unparalleled opportunities for economic development. In the mid-1990s, the federal government concluded that upon the closure and remediation of Fort Wingate, the 17,000 acres the Army no longer needed should be returned to their owners, the Zuni tribe and the Navajo Nation. In 1997, the federal government gave the two tribes the opportunity to negotiate an agreement on how the land should be divided between them. The Zuni tribe and two different Navajo Nation presidents have agreed on a 50-50 division of the lands. Under those divisions, each tribe would have received these lands that is considered to be its highest priorities in terms of economic development or cultural significance. However, each time the Navajo president agreed to a 50-50 division, the Navajo Nation Council killed the agreement, arguing that Navajo is entitled to 90% of the lands or 75% or 65%, or at one point arguing it should get 100%, but with a generous offer to give Zuni a 99 years lease on a few parcels. There is no justification for Navajo Nation to be receiving more than 50% of the lands, and Navajo Nation has never put forth any reasons. The Navajo Nation Council is simply seeking to bludgeon the Zuni tribe into giving up and to the Navajo Nation's demands for more than half of the lands. Instead of negotiating in good faith, the Navajo Nation Council has drawn out the negotiations for 15 years in hopes that the Zuni tribe will finally cave in to Navajo's unfair demands that Navajo get a majority of the lands. As a result, today we are no further along than we were 15 years ago. If Congress fails to enact legislation and permits the Navajo Nation to draw out the negotiations for another 15 years, we will be denied the opportunity to use the commercially valuable land at Fort Wingate to grow ourselves out of poverty. We also face the possibility that non-Indian governments in the area will see this commercially valuable land going to waste and make a run at it. The Navajo Nation has argued that the division of the land at Fort Wingate is an intertribal matter in which Congress has no role. The Zuni tribe agrees that the best solution would have been for the two tribes to negotiate a settlement between them. The tribes are fortunate that the federal government gave us an opportunity to agree on a fair division of the lands. But remember, these are federal lands that only Congress has the sole authority to dispose of. They are not tribal lands. When Congress gave us this opportunity to negotiate, it did not abandon its authority or its right to step in if one tribe abused that authority. That is what has happened here. The Navajo Nation Council has forfeited the opportunity by overreaching and demanding that it receive the majority of the Fort Wingate lands over the past 15 years. It is using this opportunity to negotiate given to us by the federal government to hold the Zuni tribe hostage until we give in and agree to let Navajo Nation get a majority of the lands, even though there is no justification for this. As a result, it is time for Congress to step back in and exercise its authority by imposing a deadline on negotiations, after which Congress decides how the land should be divided. There is a July 18th, 2012 letter from Navajo Nation Speaker Johnny Nasey to Congressman Pierce, in which the speaker said that legislation is not needed because the two tribes are making progress on an agreement and that an agreement is closer than one could imagine. I am not sure why Speaker Nasey was misleading the congressman, but there is not a single bit of truth in that statement. The truth is that there are no ongoing negotiations, and we are no further along in reaching an agreement today than we were when we started 15 years ago. In fact, one member of the Navajo Nation MOU team told us that the Navajo Nation Council has no intentions of even addressing the Fort Wingate situation.
Gerald, how much longer do you do you need to go?
What's that?
How much longer do you need to go here?
I'm almost finished.
Okay.
Okay. After 15 years, it's time for congressmen to declare negotiations because the process has failed. And we are asking for the committee's help, subcommittee's help in addressing this issue in H.R. In the H.R. Bill 4187. And we are proposing that what should be added to the bill is the rest of the 22 parcels that are left. So that way we don't need a second step and we don't need second legislation to go over a second time on through legislation to agree to these lands. So we are asking for the subcommittee's help on this issue. Thank you.
I thank you, Gerald. Speaker Johnny Nias.
Good afternoon, Chairman Young, Ranking Member Lujan, Yat Ishkis, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today. I'm Johnny Nias, Speaker of Navajo Nation Council and the Chairman of Navajo Nation Fort Wingate Task Force. We're here today due to an intertribal dispute between two tribal sovereigns attempting to reach a resolution on land made available through the BRAC, BRAT process. It is the nature of this disagreement that sets us apart from other disputes in land exchange. We are two sovereigns attempting to reach a mutual beneficial agreement on how best to divide up land. Federal interference is our in our dispute would be premature at best and at worst a violation of tribal sovereignty. H.R. 4187 seeks to transfer parcels that have already been remediated to the Navajo Nation and the Zuni Pueblo. This legislation assumes a 50-50 split of undefined remediated lands to at some point in the future. The bill would transfer parcel one, nearly 5,000 acres of untouched land to the Zuni Pueblos. Even though the Navajos has significant home and sacred sites claim, the bill would also transfer to the Navajo Nation Parcel 15 containing 250 acres and Parcel 17 containing 650 acres. This is a 15-84 split. Clearly, this cannot be seen as fair and is a far cry from a 50-50 rhetoric, since that split could not be achieved until an determined future date. Further, not all acres are equal. There is significant variation in the value, levels of contamination, and cultural and historic importance of the land. It is important to note that a significant amount of land cannot be remediated to a satisfactory level, either due to the level of contamination or because of a lack of fund available for the cleanup. Given the current budgetary situation of the federal government, Navajo Nation is wary of depending on federal funds to be made available for future cleanup. H.R. 4187 rests upon a mistaken belief that Navajo Nation and Zuni Tribe have come to an agreement on how the land should be divided. This belief is incorrect. Since 1997, the Navajo Nation Fort Wingate Task Force has been in place to negotiate with the Zuni Pueblo. No agreement has ever occurred on the division of land. Navajo Nation created the task force as the only Navajo entity authorized to reach any agreement on this issue. There is no division among the Navajo Nation governmental branches on this matter. Any statement made to the contrary are simply false. All parties know precisely what the Navajo process is. Navajo Nation has not entered into any agreement with the Zuni Pueblo, either through the council, the task force, or the Navajo Nation President Ben Shelley. Further, President Shelley has never been a part of any negotiation concerning the Fort Defiance Military District and has never supported a 50-50 split While it is true that the negotiation has taken a substantial amount of time, this is not unusual when there are issues of history land, historic land, and ceremonial claim to be considered. Both tribes feel that these land comprise a significant ancestral land claim. The fact is that the tribe have 8 more years to come to an agreement on how to divide the land. Given that there is significant question as to how much land could be available for transfer, the remaining time could only help to provide certainty over the amount of land ultimately available. Since the introduction of H.R. 4187, those negotiations have come to a complete halt. In the last meeting between the Navajo Nation and the Zuni Pueblo, the Zuni's position was to simply whether Navajo Nation would accept the term dictated to them by H.R. 4187. This is not a negotiation. The bill is being used by opposing party to force Navajo Nation into agreement that does not reflect any reasonable conception of fairness and is unacceptable. The introduction of H.R. 4187 has changed the nature of this dispute from disagreement over how best to divide the land to an issue of tribal sovereignty. A federally imposed solution to tribal land dispute is an affront to the very notion of tribal sovereignty. Historically, such measures have proved disastrous. Navajo Nation very much to bring this negotiation to a conclusion. Both sides have a negotiation team in place. The Navajo Nation is even willing to have an independent facilitator or mediator come in to help us work through our differences. We are dedicated to coming to terms with the Zuni Pueblo. However, we cannot accept a negotiation process circumvented in favor of a federally imposed solution. Federal action at this time is a premature imposition on tribal sovereignty and fundamentally changes the future of negotiation and issues at stake. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Well done. We're going to deviate a little bit. We'll get Mr. Marshall Grossman to private landowner in Santa Barbara County.
Thank you very much for your invitation to appear here today. Thank you very much again for the kind invitation to appear here today. My name is Marshall Grossman. I'm a lawyer engaged in the private practice of law. I have also had the pleasure of serving my state on 2 state commissions for an aggregate of some 16 years. Our family has been privileged to own a 29-acre ranch in Santa Barbara County's San Ynez Valley since 1979. We are directly across the road from the 1,400-acre non-reservation land recently purchased by the San Ynez Band and which is now subject to a potential fee to trust conversion. The valley is well known for its bucolic setting of open space, oak trees, ranches, and over 100 wineries. The towns in the San Ynez Valley are small and western in character, with populations of a few thousand maximum and as small as a few hundred. The 1,400 acres is the gateway to the valley. It is a picture-perfect panorama, a pastoral beauty, generously graced with historic and protected oak trees. It is non-Indian reservation and is located 2 miles plus from the tribe's reservation and casino. It is unthinkable that the Interior Department is vested with the legal power to approve unchecked development on these 1,400 acres, an area which is the size of the valley's largest town. The absence of meaningful standards for reviewing fee-to-trust conversions permits the Interior Department to rubber stamp transfers regardless of their impact on the community. This is not a fear, it is a reality. In California, between 2001 and 2011, there were 110 applications for fee-to-trust conversions. Every one of them was approved. The tribal interests are well protected. The interests of others are not. Most often they are simply ignored. No pun intended, but the deck is stacked. The San Ynez Valley Community Land Use Plan enacted in 2009 represents sound and well-received planning for the San Ynez Valley. But that matters not to the tribe. And why should it? The present law governing conversions would never be mistaken for good government. The existing land use plan can be set aside by the Interior Department with the stroke of a pen. The transfer of these 1,400 acres would benefit a small fraction of the community and its unidentified financial backers at the expense of countless others. Fee to trust should be based on mutual respect for and between tribal governments and responsible stakeholders. The current system fosters distrust, not cooperation, as exemplified by the many-year fight over a fee-to-trust conversion of 6.9 acres right next to the Indian reservation. That fight was unnecessary and could have been prevented had there been more meaningful and appropriate regulations in effect and laws on the books. Today, there is little reason for tribes to compromise and no way to enforce compromise if provided. In 2003, the 143-member San Ynez Band sought to develop this same designated non-reservation agricultural land with its prior owner, Fess Parker. Two golf courses, a 300-unit resort hotel, and 500 residential units. In the face of widespread community opposition, the plan was dropped. The band now claims that it will only use the land to house its members. Its prior development plans strongly suggest otherwise. Moreover, the naked statement or promise of intended use means nothing. Once land is taken into trust, it may be used for any purpose, with no consideration for local laws and scant for federal law. This has happened many times in the past in different parts of the country. The current regulations allow conversion in trust, quote, when the secretary determines that the acquisition of land is necessary to facilitate tribal self-determination, economic development, or Indian housing, close quote. That's it. This standard is no standard at all. Stakeholder government agencies are now barred from providing the secretary with their views and concerns about potential land use. What can Congress do? Three things. I'll mention them briefly. First, Congress can require the secretary to adopt regulations to ensure that the secretary must give weight to the comments of state and local government officials and community stakeholders, specifically including the potential impacts on land and land use planning and environmental factors. Second, Congress can require the secretary to consider imposing restrictions and agreements on the future use of land being taken in trust. Restrictions which respect tribal sovereignty and flexibility and the concerns of government and citizen stakeholders. And third, Congress should require negotiations with the stakeholders who will be impacted by the land being taken into trust. I thank you very much for your service to our country and your consideration of my views. I find it an honor and a privilege to appear before Congress. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Grossman. Chairman Vincent Armati.
Good afternoon, Chairman Young, Ranking Member Lujan, and members of the committee. I am Vincent Armenta. I'm the tribal chairman for the San Ynez Band of Chumash Indians. First, I'd like to thank you for this opportunity, not for myself, but representing our tribe to testify here today. Our tribe has been around for thousands of years, and at one time, our territory stretched from Malibu to Paso Robles, over 200 miles stretch of California coastline. Although we were relegated to 99 acres in a floodplain, we have made the most of it. In spite of the hardships we have endured, our tribal government had always done its best to provide for the basic needs of our tribal membership. For example, in 1969, our tribal government, for the first time, secured water, running water on our reservation. A little difficult to believe that that was only 43 years ago when I was 6 years old. My responsibility, along with the four members of our tribal leadership team, is to continue to provide services for our membership. But recently, we have found that it is difficult to accomplish that when it comes to land issues. We are currently facing challenges on two fee to trust projects. One is an effort to bring land into trust for tribal housing. The other is an effort to build a museum. Unfortunately, some members of the local government have become involved in tribal issues in a way that could have serious impacts on tribal sovereignty. Their actions reveal an attitude of, we respect tribal sovereignty up until the point you actually seek to exercise it. 12 years and two approvals ago, after submitting our first application for the 6.9 acres to the Bureau of Indian Affairs, we are still held up in an appeal process. Local anti-tribal groups in our community have spent nearly $2 million to prevent us from placing land in a trust for the purpose of building a museum and protecting a tribal cemetery and a cultural site. Given the experience we have had with the administrative process, we felt no other alternative to explore but to explore the legislative route for our other Feed a Trust project, which would return 1,400 acres of our ancestral land back to the tribe. Developing homes on this parcel, known as Camp 4, would allow our people to live together as tribal families under our own tribal government. In recent years, housing has become a critical concern. There is simply no room on a reservation to provide adequate housing for our tribal families. Most of our small reservation is made up of a creek bed and its banks, an area where our ancestors were forced to take refuge. Providing more housing of this kind is the kind of progress that the federal government envisioned when it began to support tribal economic development opportunities. But ironically, local tribal opponents and even some elected officials have accused our tribe of being too wealthy to benefit from the Feed a Trust process. Chairman Young, a letter from one of our local elected officials was sent to you directly, in which the individual states that the Feed a Trust process was established solely for economic benefit. According to that definition, when a tribe experiences some level of economic success, they no longer need to pursue Feed a Trust and instead should follow the local land use planning process. The idea that our tribe's ability to exercise sovereignty should somehow be linked to our Bain statement is not only insulting, but goes against everything that Congress has done to provide a pathway for tribes to reach self-determination. Mr. Chairman, housing is a basic need, not an economic investment for profit. We have many investment properties that are not in federal trusts, but we strongly believe that our tribal homes need to be part of our reservation. A recent report from the U.S. Senate Committee on Indian Affairs restated that the trust acquisition process is not limited to only landless or destitute tribes. For 78 years, the Feed a Trust process has been essential for tribal governments to add land to the reservations. Affirming the process means keeping tribal communities together and encouraging future generations to live on the reservation under their tribal government. For our tribe, it's about building a stronger community so we can build and secure a future for our members. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm going to recognize Mr. McClintock and then Mr. Lujan and then Mr. Jeff Denham and then Mr. Kildee. Then I might recognize myself. Mr. McClintock.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Black, let me begin with you, and pardon me for a very elementary question, but I think it's at the core of the whole issue that's being explored here, and that is, is there a specific and standardized criteria for taking land into trust, and if so, what are the guidelines to do so?
The guidelines for bringing lands into trust and all the considerations that we take are under 25 CFR Part 151.10 for on-reservation trust acquisitions and Part 151.11 for off-reservation acquisitions.
I appreciate that, but I don't speak bureaucracy.
I apologize.
Could you translate that into English?
Basically, it outlines the criteria we are to take to consider any application that comes into land or for a land into trust.
And what are these criteria?
Well, I don't know all of them right off the top of my head, but they take in everything from the need for a tribe for the land, the purpose of the land. There again, whether it's on reservation or off reservation, there's approximately about 8 criteria that are involved.
How much of these criteria are strictly objective, and how many are subjective?
I don't have a good answer for that, sir.
Does anyone on the panel know the answer to that question? It does seem to me, for example, I'm pretty familiar with the situation with the Chumash. I represented that area in the state Senate for many years, and it's very clear to me what's going on. Santa Barbara has rabidly NIMBY policy, not in my backyard policy, when it comes to housing development. It is a policy that has utterly ravaged the economy. It has all but destroyed the middle class in Santa Barbara. The Chumash are seeking some way to get around that, and I certainly don't blame them. On the other hand, it's not entirely clear to me whether the Chumash, or for that matter, any tribe would meet the criteria to do so. In other words, I'm leery of setting up a situation where we have two classes of citizens, one of which can evade the folly of Santa Barbara's laws, for example, and the other that must bear the folly of those laws. It seems to me that when a tribe purchases land outside of its reservation, that land is subject to all the local ordinances, even the really stupid ones. Can you, Chairman Armetta, can you give me some guidance on this?
Thank you, Mr. McClintock. You know, I can. I think as we took a look at bringing land into trust, in particular on the two parcels that we currently seek, the 6.9 and the 1,400 acres, one of the purposes of that on the 6.9 in particular was to protect a tribal cemetery and a cultural site. I know that was taken in consideration when we did submit our application for that. The second for one of the qualifications or pre-qualifications or determination factors whether or not land can be brought into trust was the fact that our existing reservation, original reservation, was 99 acres with over half of that undevelopable. So even if we had
and
the entire...
This was when?
This was in 1901.
Right.
This 1,400 acre parcel we're talking about, the tribe actually at one point in time was on title to this land. It was owned by the Archdiocese on behalf of the tribe, sued in 1906. The Archdiocese sued the federal government to take the tribe off.
Is it your contention then that the Chumash tribe qualifies under the provisions that Mr. Black cited but can't remember?
Yes, it is.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Luan.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Black, after filing in 2000, BIA recently reapproved the tribe's land into trust application for the 6.9 acres of land located across the highway from its existing reservation. Now I understand that decision has been appealed. Can the BIA finalize the tribe's land into trust application for the 6.9 acre parcel if an appeal is pending?
No, we cannot, sir, not until the appeal is decided.
So assuming the local opponents to the Chumash's land into trust petition exhaust their administrative remedies and then appeals to federal court, could the tribe potentially be waiting another 12 years or more to see the land placed into trust?
You know, I would have to answer potentially, possibly, but I don't know. That's all dependent upon the federal court process and the decisions that would come out of there.
It just seems like a long time.
Yes, it does.
If I ask the question. Mr. Grossman, is there opposition to the Santa Ynez Band of taking that land into trust where they have a cemetery?
The 6.9 acres,
yes,
you're referring to? I'm certainly not opposed to it. There was opposition within the community, and the community did ask, I should say certain members of the community, asked the Board of Supervisors of Santa Barbara County to object to that transfer, and the board voted 3-2 not to appeal, not to object, and not to join with those members of the communities who are opposed to it. If I may expand just a bit, I think that what happened on that 6.9 acres is really a tragedy, and the delay is unconscionable. I believe that part of what happened there is directly attributable to the lack of an opportunity for the local citizenry to be heard before the Bureau of Indian Affairs. They tried to get a seat at the table, and they were turned down. So they went to federal court and obtained a court order to the Bureau of Indian Affairs requiring the Bureau to provide individual citizen stakeholders, including residents who live directly across from this parcel, to be heard by the Bureau. So my request for help from Congress is to help eliminate that type of conflict, and where fee to trust is appropriate, grant it and get it done with, and where it isn't, make sure that the appropriate stakeholder voices are heard in opposition.
I appreciate that, Mr. Grossman. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Governor, or I apologize, Councilman Hui and Speaker Nays, who has the authority to negotiate and approve an agreement on the Four Wind Gate lands with your respective tribes? And council member, I'll start with you.
Thank you, Congressman. It's the governor and the Zuni Tribal Council that have the authority to negotiate and sign off on an agreement for any lands.
Thank you. And Speaker Nays?
Mr. Lujan, pretty much similar. The Navajo Nation Council would recognize a committee to be given that designation, the authority to negotiate. And this, in this case, it will be the Navajo Nation Fort Wayne Gate Task Force.
And that committee has been established, correct, Mr. Speaker?
That's correct, Mr. Lujan.
Very good. And do both tribal leaders understand that the tribes have until 2020 to come up with an agreement on the Fort Wayne Gate lands?
Yes, we're aware of that.
Council member?
Yes, we are.
Mr. Chairman, one thing that I think is important to point out, we heard a lot about the contaminated lands, and you know, as we talk about this issue, I'm glad that Mr. Black is here, but I would suggest that we need someone from the Department of Defense also to talk about the notion of the cleanup of these lands. We can transfer some lands, Mr. Chairman, but what I would hate to do is transfer lands and essentially give two tribes a dump and tell them, we've given you this land, now do with it whatever you can, which there may be not much. And so hopefully at a later time, we'll be able to get some of that testimony from the DOD.
The gentleman yield, I can assure you that if we write legislation, it'll be, I happen to agree with the Gerald on the idea of one lump bill, but it'll be with a covenant that before the lands can be totally taken over, that the responsibility of cleaning it up remains with those that originally owned it. That'd be the Army. And they would have to do it. We do this in Alaska all the time because otherwise we'd be forever not getting something done, so it can be done.
I appreciate that, Mr. Chairman. To both the council member and to the speaker, are you both willing to organize your decision-making bodies to come to a meeting with me and Mr. Pierce to come up with an agreeable solution from which legislation can be created and supported by both our offices?
The Zuni tribe is.
Mr. Speaker, would that be something that the Navajo Nation would be open to?
Mr. Lujan, yes, we'll be open to that.
I appreciate that very much, and I would like to ask and respectfully request from both our tribal members that they visit with their respective advisory bodies that have jurisdiction over this transfer and to submit a proposal to my office and to this committee within 30 days, if at all possible, for a division that we could talk about with the Fort Wingate lands that may be agreeable to your tribe and start a process to do this. Mr. Chairman, you know, this is a land transfer in the 3rd Congressional District, which is the district that I represent, and I'm hoping that we'll be able to work with our respective tribal leaders through consultation to come up with that approach. So thank you for your indulgence, and I thank all the witnesses for being here today.
Mr. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Black, in your written testimony, you have it here, the power to acquire lands in trust is an important tool for the United States to effectuate its long-standing policy of fostering tribal self-determination. Further go on to say, to secure all Indian tribes a land base on which to engage in economic development and self-determination. And then finally, you use it as an example, trust acquisitions provide tribes the ability to enhance housing opportunities for their citizens. This is particularly necessary where many reservation economies require support from the tribal government to bolster local housing markets and offset high unemployment rates. So my question to you is, if a tribe such as Chumash is lacking adequate housing or a sufficient number of housing to house its tribal members, just to house its people, is this not the very tribal self-determination that you describe in both your testimony as well as on your website and in your mission statement?
If I understand your question, sir, I believe it is, yes. By allowing the tribe the opportunity to bring lands into trust, it gives them the opportunity to establish residential areas and different housing areas and other economic opportunities within those lands.
Thank you. And Chairman Armenta, this new property that actually your ancestral property that you're now able to purchase. How is that going to differ from adjacent lands and the housing communities that are around that property?
Well, currently, the 1,400 acres consists of grasslands and vineyards, which do quite a bit of the surrounding area. But located to the east of our property is a high-density housing development, which would be similar to what we have, although there will be double the houses on half of the property size. It would be very similar to what surrounds it.
So on this property, you currently have vineyards?
On this property, there's currently 250 acres of vineyards.
And there's vineyards all around it?
And there's vineyards all around it, and there's housing developments around it as well.
And part of that property is currently grazing. It's going to continue to be the adjacent areas are as well.
It'll continue to be grazeland, yes.
And there is a portion around that area that has been developed into houses, and you're looking at developing
We are looking to develop to the similar development to the east of this, which is a housing development, a public housing development.
So my question, Mr. Grossman, you know, if the Chumash have been in the valley for hundreds, if not thousands of years in that area, what are some examples of how this is going to differ from the current use in that area?
Well, I would respectfully disagree with my colleague, President Armenta. We have provided as an appendix the map of the area, and a look at that map will quickly convey that virtually all of this area is agriculture land. Most of it is in under the protection of the Williamson Act, California Agricultural Land Act. Relatively little of it is developed. Most of the development are horse ranch or horse breeding facilities, ostrich farms, vineyards, and the like. Housing is now permitted on that 1,400 acres, clearly not of the density of 500 homes. But as a private property owner in the area, the Chumash are certainly entitled to go before the local planning authorities and ask for an amendment to the general plan. I can't predict what that outcome would be, but I doubt it would be 500 homes. As an alternative, they certainly had the right previously and still have the right to purchase other land.
Mr. Grossman, I'm going to stop you because my time is short. What is on your property currently?
We farm it. It's farmed.
What do you farm on that property?
Hay, oats, and the like.
And is that different from the vineyards or the grazeland that is going to be on the 1,400 acres, the portion that would be adjacent to your property?
Yes. There are not 500 houses anywhere inside of our property or inside of most of the property in that area. There is housing facility and opportunity in that area, and it's zoned for housing.
There is housing zoned in that area, and there is adjacent housing in that area as well.
Not in the immediate area. The area that is zoned for housing is zoned for housing. This entire area on that side of the highway, which you'll see on the map, none of it, I believe, is zoned for housing. It's all agricultural land.
Thank you.
Mr. Kildee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Black, is the decision of the United States government regarding taking land into trust, does it find its roots in the Constitution of the United States?
Boy, sir, I don't know if I'm in a position to say yes or no to that question. Understanding fully, but it does, you know, it's a discretionary decision to bring land into trust, and it's based in the statute under the Indian Reorganization Act of 34.
But also the Indian Reorganization Act finds its roots in the Constitution, the original Constitution, the unamended Constitution even, says the Congress shall have the power to regulate commerce with foreign nations and with the several states and with the Indian tribes.
Yes.
There's a certain treaty relationship and a certain recognition of sovereignty in that. As a matter of fact, on Article 6, it says, of this Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made in pursuance thereof, and all treaties made or which shall be made under the authority of the United States, shall be the supreme law of the land, and the judges in every state shall be bound thereby. Anything in the Constitution or laws of any state to the contrary, notwithstanding. Now, John Marshall indicated that that applied to Indian treaties. So I say the roots of our fiduciary responsibility to the Indian tribes do go back to the fact that we recognize them as sovereigns. It says to regulate commerce with foreign nations and among the several states and with the Indian tribes. And then it indicates that notwithstanding any other state laws or decisions that the treaties have to be recognized. I say that because I just said the roots of these decisions, I think, go back to the Constitution. In Michigan, it's very clear. I helped five tribes regain the recognition of their sovereignty, not the granting of their sovereignty. We don't grant France its sovereignty under this. We recognize it. The Treaty of Detroit, I read the Treaty of Detroit back in 1965, my first year in public office. And Treaty of Detroit promised certain things that were never kept. And finally, the courts and Congress has gone back and reclaimed land, for example, for tribes that were promised to them in perpetuity by the treaties. So the Constitution did protect specifically and with the Indian tribes. And much of our effort to protect the Indian rights to have land, which is the anchor for sovereignty, is very clear, and it's been John Marshall himself, who made the greatest decisions probably in the early days of the Republic, indicated that those treaties were valid treaties. Do you have any comment on that?
I don't, sir. I think that's great. That was a great lesson for me, what you had to say there. But not being a constitutional expert or an attorney and stuff, I still don't know if I could properly or, you know, really adequately address your question.
Well, you know, I think that as the director of the Bureau of Indian Affairs, I never leave home without this. That's the Constitution. I use it for various purposes, but you know, I use it probably, as Mr. Young, my chairman, indicated, I use it in Indian law quite often because our founding fathers recognized that we had some responsibilities to the Native Americans and put that in the Constitution. So I think the roots of some of the things we do, of taking land into trust, and recognize their sovereignty over that land, the roots are in the Constitution. And I take an oath every 2 years for the last 48 years to uphold this Constitution. So get a copy, carry one on your inside pocket.
I will, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Black.
I thank the gentleman. I got a couple of questions I'd like to ask. Mr. Black, why is congressional action necessary to place the Fort Wainwright lands into trust?
The department lacks a statutory authority due to the public domain status of the lands. We can't transfer them into trust status. Therefore, it requires congressional action.
So we will have to have congressional action.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm going to suggest to the Sunnis and the Navajos that I hope you take Mr. Ulan's suggestion sincerely, because I've been in this business a long time. 15 years is too long. And I'm going to suggest that you either come up with a solution, quit dragging your feet, I read the agreement was signed before, and some people say it's not an agreement because it wasn't okayed by the Total Navajo organization, and the Zunis say it was done because of the president. I don't want this land to go back to the federal government. We could introduce a bill, and I probably would get the votes for it, believe it or not, even from this side, to make it a park. It's federal land. And if you want this land, which I do think it's your due, I'm going to suggest you do that meeting with Mr. Lujan and Mr. Pence, and I will be supervising, and I've cut a baby in half many, many times. So I'm just asking you to do that, because when brothers start fighting brothers in this business, no one wins. And you can have right on your side, and by God, I'm not going to listen to it, and Congress has nothing to do with it. Well, in reality, Congress does have something to do with it. And I just want you to make sure you understand what I'm saying. I don't like to get involved in his backyard or Steve's backyard. I'd like to stay out of it, but we will get into it. I want this solved. It's time. 15 years you have to 2020. I don't want to be around there saying, why isn't this done in 2020? So that's just a little suggestion. I'm more interested, you know, Mr. Grossman, you say there's no housing close by, and I got a map here that shows a large housing, big housing area right close to the land that's at 1,400 acres, and you say there's no housing there?
What I said, Mr. Chairman, is that on the other side of the highway where this parcel is, the 1,400 acres, you will see that the surrounding areas are agricultural. On the extreme right-hand side of the map you're looking at, there are lots, some of which are developed, some which are not, but there is nothing of the type of the density. There's no housing developments in that area at all.
Well, wait, in all due respects, all they're suggesting is they want the same density-type housing on the left-hand side of my side, and you can see what I'm talking about. That's not near the highway. This is way back up here.
Your Honor, is that
true, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir, it is.
I mean, what's the difference? You've got housing here, and this was ag land at one time. It says so. And this is ag land, says so. And they want to build housing for the tribal members here. They can't build it over here. This reservation is 90 acres. What, 40 acres is hospitable?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what's the difference between this and this?
Well, I would submit, Your Honor, Mr. Chairman, that they should go and acquire land which is presently zoned for housing and respect the local government and the local government's authority to control land use policies in this area.
Well, I understand what you're saying, but it seems to me that I'm going to take your words for it, Mr. Mencott. If there is housing, though, right next door, what's wrong with putting housing on the land that they own?
There is not housing right next door. This is 1,700 acres. This parcel is the size of the largest town in the San Ynez Valley.
But they're not building houses on all 1,400 acres, are you, Mr. Chairman?
No, sir.
You're building it in this corner lot, really?
Yes, sir.
And about how many houses?
143.
Okay. Now, if we were to solve this problem, really, instead of going in the trust, what would happen if they would take and pick out this acreage and the commissioners would classify it as housing land? That would solve the problem, wouldn't it?
Well, they can currently build housing on this land. The current law permits them to build 28 houses on this land. And if they wished an amendment to build more houses, their responsibility would seek, like any other owner of private property in this area, any other non-reservation land, to go to the local government and seek an amendment to the community plan.
Now, Chairman, have you sought amendments to try to get more housing there?
Mr. Chairman, we have tried to work with the county on several issues. It took us 2 years to get approved a gas station on a commercial highway parcel. 2 years. With all due respect, this at this point in time, this isn't a land issue, this is a government issue. Mr. Grossman brings up the fact that we should seek the authority of a local government. I think what we should do is each other respect the authorities of not only the local government, but the tribal government as well.
Well, the reality is you can't be treated that way on land that's not in trust. Is that correct? Private
correct.
Land. They don't have to treat you as government on private land.
Correct.
So if it was put in the trust, they would have to be government to government.
Correct.
Okay. I'm about out of time. Mr. McClintock or Mr. Jeff, which you got any more questions? Mr. Jeff?
Mr. Black, in your testimony, you mentioned that through the allotment process, the tribes lost over 80 million acres of land since 1887. That's a huge number. I'm just curious, what's the ballpark sense of how many acres of those lost lands that tribes have lost have been reclaimed over the last 100 years?
Currently, we're carrying about 56 million acres of land in trust for the tribes.
And Chairman Armenta, could you... can you talk a minute about your responsibility as a chairman of the self-determination of your tribe and making sure that those that are seeking housing on the reservation and some of the challenges that you're facing with making sure that they have that housing?
Yes. My responsibility as a tribal chairman is really for the welfare and the protection of our tribe. Congress gave, the United States government gave the tribes an economic opportunity to provide for itself. Part of the reasoning behind that was to make sure that the tribal leaders would do what is diligent and provide the necessary basic services for its membership, which include housing, which include education, and which includes healthcare. To assume that because a tribe is economically well off, they should not have a reservation anymore is completely opposite of what Congress has intended. Our responsibility as a tribal leader is to protect not only my generation, but the future generation of our tribes, and to ensure that our tribe has the ability to practice its sovereign rights within the future. That is our responsibility as tribal leaders.
And do you currently have the ability to add more houses on your current reservation?
No, sir, we do not. As I mentioned earlier, our original reservation was 99 acres, over half of that a floodplain in a hillside. Since then, our reservation has grown to 140 acres. On that 140 acres, we have 75 homes. And still, remember that 50% of the reservation we cannot develop. We have a tribal government center and a healthcare center that not only provides for our tribal membership, but for all the Native American population in Santa Barbara, and is a last resource medical center for all the people in Santa Barbara County.
Thank you, Mr. Black. Do you believe that the Chumash tribe has the opportunity to expand on housing in their current reservation?
I don't know the exact layout of their current reservation, sir, other than I know that they have, like he said, about 50% of it is basically can't be developed for housing. They have a lot of other activities on the lands that they have now. So I think that's really the determination under self-determination and sovereignty of the tribe to make that determination.
Thank you. And their current reservation, although it be a very small reservation, at one point they did own, from all the documentation I'm seeing here, quite a bit of property in the surrounding area. And certainly have sovereignty ties to that entire area. Do you dispute that?
No, I don't, sir.
Thank you. I yield back.
Mr. Luan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Armenta, some of the things that were brought up in other testimony were concerns around water resources or scenic values. Can you talk a little bit about what you're describing with that parcel, with the larger parcel there, and I think what Chairman Young has pointed out where it's clear on the maps that we have that there's a residential development with smaller land plats and plots adjacent to the property. So can you talk to us a little bit about that?
I can, and I can only speak to our tribe, but I've seen through the exercise of many other tribes that tribal governments are the original stewards. Native Americans are the original stewards of the land. And I believe we have shown that responsibility on our reservation as well as on other land that we own. So we do respect the oak trees. We do respect the land itself. I think that is instilled in all Native Americans. In regards to the housing development, if your map encompasses the entire 1,400 acres in which we are talking about and the nearby surrounding lots, directly adjacent to the 1,400 acres is a development of over 150 homes. When I stand on the 1,400 acres at the fence line, I am in backyards of 150 homes, or a number of those 150 homes.
And Mr. Chairman, would the development that you would develop if you acquired these lands into trust be consistent with that development architecturally or anything else? Is there?
It would certainly be consistent with the neighboring homes and the subdivision of those homes.
And Mr. Grossman, have there been efforts to sit down with the tribe and talk about those efforts where if it's consistent with the parcel adjacent to it and with the concerns associated with water resources and scenic values?
Not to my knowledge. I believe that the focus of both the tribe and the stakeholder groups has been, unfortunately, on that 6.9 acre parcel. And I would only add to my knowledge, the land in question has never been Indian reservation or recognized as sovereign land. As the tribal chairman or president has said, the Chumash occupied a 200-mile long area and occupied various portions of that along the California coast. This land is no different than any of that, but it is not reservation land. It was purchased from a private party, and today it is under Santa Barbara County land use regulations and was purchased with that knowledge in mind.
I appreciate that, Mr. Grossman. You know, the way that I was raised as well and the way that I take to heart working on policy here is when you sometimes find yourself at an impasse, it's amazing what can be accomplished when you sit across the table in good faith to try to work some things out. And whether it's the issue in New Mexico that I'm hoping that our brothers and our sisters are able to find some resolution to, I'm hopeful that when good neighbors and friends choose to sit down and talk, that we can find some resolution. And I would encourage the community to, pertaining to the cemetery and the burial and sacred site, that we think about it in that regard, because there's sacred sites all over the country, whether they're the churches that I belong to as a Catholic or other areas of worship of significance around the world, that we need to pay them with the same respect and dignity. And I hope that we can find some resolution along those areas and that our neighbors can work amongst each other, because we're always better off when we look out for one another, when we cross the street or we walk down the sidewalk, and we keep each other safe as a community. And I hope that we can accomplish this together. So,
I appreciate that. For years, I protected Indian sites of culture and heritage through my service on a state land use regulatory commission. I believe that one of the areas of the law that Congress could pass, which would facilitate the very type of dialogue that you're suggesting, is that there be a mechanism so that agreements made of the very type that you are referring to would be binding upon both the community and the tribe after a fee to trust transfer. Right now, they are not binding. They're not enforceable. And there have been many instances of broken promises as to what was intended to be done on land transferred from fee to trust. That's something we would be most appreciated if you could look at. Make those agreements enforceable.
Thank you for your input there, Mr. Grossman, your response. To all of our witnesses, Mr. Chairman, again, thank you for taking the time to be here today. Thank you, Chairman.
Mr. Denham.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Armenta, I'm having a hard time understanding what the big issue is here. I've been out, I've seen that property. You've got vineyards on there, you've got an ag use, you got grazing land, there's grazing land around it, there's ag use around it, there's other vineyards around it. There's land, obviously, according to this map, you can see that there's land already been developed and housing. You're looking at providing some housing for your tribe. I think the big question here is really, you know, under the 99 compacts, you have the ability to put in two casinos. Are you looking at putting a casino in on this property?
Excuse me, Mr. Denham. We have no interest in putting a casino on this property. As a matter of fact, when we started to seek the opportunity or explore the opportunity to bring this land into trust, through legislation. I myself offered language be put in any legislation that would not allow gaming. Our tribe is very serious about providing houses for its membership, as am I. We have offered that up in our initial conversations exploring the legislative route on this.
Thank you. And Mr. Chairman, I would just add that, you know, in California under Prop 5 and Prop 1A, that's exactly what the voters did approve, was to make sure that there was self-determination and that the tribes that were able to have economic development that was going to be able to provide for their tribes, that's exactly what this was intended to do, so that tribes would be able to actually go out and have housing and have economic development and have health care and education for their tribes. I mean, this is completely about self-determination, and I see no reason why this tribe would not have that opportunity.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. Back. Mr. Black, could you take in those 6 acres in trust right now?
No, sir. It's
why not?
It's currently under appeal with IBIA, I understand.
So it does take legislation then?
And the 6-point acre, no, it won't take, it's not dependent upon legislation for the, you're talking about the acreage under.
Yeah, for the museum.
No, like I say, it's under appeal with IBIA right now. Until those appeals are exhausted, I don't have authority to bring that land into trust.
If the chairman would yield.
Yeah, gladly. I'm trying to find a solution to that.
Mr. Black, this has already been approved, correct, by the BIA? After it was, is that correct?
Yes, we've issued the decision to bring it into trust twice now.
And after that, the last approval process, then it was appealed, is that correct?
Right.
And so it's currently in the appeal process?
Yes.
Okay. That appeal process prevents BIA from taking action, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And so such that if there is legislative action, that would give us a track to move forward if that was what the Congress decided to do?
Okay. I would assume. Now, who filed the appeal? The counselor, the commissioners of the county?
I believe the appeal was either filed by the county or there's two opposition groups out there in that area.
Okay, now can they continue this?
Well, it sets with IBIA, which can be anywhere up to a 2-year period to finalize an appeal with the Interior Board of Indian Appeals right now.
Well, that's in your department.
It's an administrative appeal process.
Now, are they doing their job expeditiously, or are they dragging their feet, or what's occurring?
No, I believe they're doing their job, sir. It's just okay.
What I'm suggesting that we can solve this congressionally, which would be my intent, especially if it's for a museum. I would suggest that they ought to look at this and see if they can solve it. And the third time, I'll guarantee if it's appealed again, it will be solved congressionally, because apparently you had that right. Now, I'm going to ask the chairman, if what you tell me, you don't want to build another casino, all you want is housing. What if we were to, you own all this land, what if we were to take a chunk out of this and make it in trust instead of the whole thing in trust? What would happen then?
Well, Mr. Chairman, that would certainly address the issue of the housing, which is what we are moving towards. It's difficult. Part of the reason for buying the larger section, because originally we did just try to buy a couple hundred acres out in that area, actually in several different areas, to address the housing needs. The purpose of buying the entire property, there was two reasons. Number one, we could not buy just one part of it. Number two was for the ability of the future generations of our tribe to exercise its right as a sovereign government. Separating it certainly would cure the housing issue. But the purpose of the land was not just for housing today, but it was for our tribal government 100 years from now, 200 years from now. I don't believe I will be here, but I certainly want to make sure I can do whatever I can today to protect and give our future generation of tribal leaders and membership the ability to carry on as a sovereign government.
All right, I understand that, but of course that falls into the commissioner's objection to the housing. He said that Mr. Grossman's statement was that nothing is permanent, it can be changed at any time, and other land uses might occur, and that's true. But I'm trying to seek a way that that we could possibly make this go a little more rapidly. And I think the quickest way would be, what had happened if the commissioners would come down and you didn't build dense housing, you could build, how much housing do you think you'd need now?
Approximately 150 homes, sir.
Okay, it's 150 homes, so you could take and give them 2 acre homes, you're talking about approximately 500 acres of 1,400 acres that could be built, a 2 acre lot. That's certainly not density housing. That's pretty nice housing.
Yes, sir, I agree.
Okay, if that was to happen, if the commissioners would come down and give you that, if you applied for that, you could do that? Would you be interested in doing that?
If we split it and put part of it into trust for homes and the other part, I believe our tribe would be ecstatic about that.
But the size of what I'm saying, if they were to give you an opportunity to build homes on 2 acre lots, would you be able to do that? Or would you want to do it? I mean, I know closer the homes are, the cheaper they are, but they couldn't complain about, we don't want a ghetto-type housing being built, although there's a whole pile of them on the other side. And I'm just wondering what happens to the commissioner, and if you were to offer that, if they would accept that sort of thing.
And a question came up earlier, has there been any communication between the two parties? Over 370 days ago, I gave the county commissioner, the county board of supervisors, a draft cooperative agreement that would allow us to work through these issues. 370 days later, I have not had a response from them. So for somebody to say we could meet with or could possibly do this, we cannot do it simply because the other party will not meet, and we have 370 days and counting waiting for that meeting addressing those exact issues.
All right, what I'm going to suggest, would you submit that letter or that agreement that you submitted to the commissioners to this committee so we can look at it?
Yes, I will, sir.
Okay, because that might make a good grounds for a piece of legislation to solve the issue, and that means everybody would have to start thinking about it, because I told the Sunnis and the Navajos, you don't want me whacking that baby up. I'll guarantee you don't. And maybe we have a way to get this issue settled and get it done, because I am a great private land holder, and I don't like government telling me what I can and cannot do on my own land. I want everybody to understand that, Mr. Grossman, and tell your commissioners that. I hate any form of structure, as long as I'm not hurting my neighbors physically or not ethnic, not view bit. I don't like someone telling me what to do. That's why I'm in Alaska. I'm an ex-Californian. One reason I went to Alaska is because of that. And all you do in California now is tell you can't do that, you can't do this, and even in infected Alaska, they're going to have a smoke-free fair. In a land of the free and the last frontier, a smoke-free fair. I mean, it's creeping, this whole thing about Big Brother is creeping now, so I don't want it to happen anymore. All right, gentlemen, I do thank you, and my advice, this has been a hearing trying to gain knowledge, and I think we've done that, and I'm asking you all to consider it. Mr. Black, if you got any ideas how we can expedite your process, make it easier, let us know, make it more succinct so that it's subjective, and what did he say, subjective and objective, so we can straighten that out too, I'd appreciate it. And the rest of you, have a good day. Enjoy the Washington, D.C. heat, and we will probably see you again. I hope not. I hope it's a solved question, solved problem. Thank you very much. This committee's adjourned.
You know, I don't know if it would be of any interest to you or not, but if you were interested in pursuing his suggestion of taking a couple hundred acres, whatever it is, and putting in a couple hundred homes on 2 acre home sites, and keeping the rest of it in trust so that you had complete sovereignty over it, and taking the rest of it and committing to leave it outside of trust, I would be very supportive of that. And I would be happy to work, not professionally, but as a neighbor,